get finished on time. Well, thank you very much for inviting me to this presentation in front of this illustrious round of Zurich alumni. I can say that because I'm not a Zurich alumni. I'm actually an alumni of further east from St. Gallen. Did my political science or political economy studies there back in the day, but that's ages. Ever since, I've been very keen and very interested in the whole topic of innovation. I think you could call me an innovation nerd, and I've been observing, always having the latest gadgets and whatnot, and I've been permanently frustrated by the lack of innovation in the financial services industry. So there's always this tension between what technology does, what sciences do, and what finance does not. So it's really quite satisfying and positive now that that the financial services industry finally seems to be catching up on what is actually happening in the world out there. But the question is it just technology that's being relevant, that is having an impact on the innovation of finance? And that's the topic that we are going to explore tonight. And I am actually hopefully as keen to learn more about this topic as you are, because I would like to get you to participate and ask questions interactively, because what I'm doing here is presenting some ideas and observations that I've captured over the last two decades observing this industry. And I would like to basically have you as a sounding board for these ideas that I'm gonna present to you. So let's get started. An error occurred. Please try again later. So the evidently the video is not going to show. This is actually a brief video introduction about the CFA Society, which would be running for about 2 minutes, about what we are doing, who we are, etc. I'll try to do that very briefly in my words here. The CFA designation has been very successful in Switzerland because it's got some 3,000 members now, ever since it's been introduced back in 1996, and an enormous growth rate, obviously. The mission of CFA Switzerland is actually to be, as this organization is, an alumni organization of all the CFA charter holders, making sure that members have opportunities to continue their education, to build networking events as well, and to represent the values of the CFA designation, which has a pretty firm code of ethics and standards of professional conduct towards the stakeholders in the industry. So our slogan is professionalism and finance, professionalism and ethics for the Finanzplatz. So that's basically what briefly sums up what CFA Switzerland is all about. But that's not the only reason why I'm actually here. There's two more relevant associations, and I think the first one, the Swiss Finance and Technology Association, is the reason why I'm actually really invited here. I am on the board of the Swiss Finance and Technology Association, which is a network, loose network, countrywide network of about 600 people who are interested in the developments of finance and technology in Switzerland. So the mission of that association is to foster the ecosystem, that network that is interested in that topic in Switzerland. We're also doing advocacy, i.e. commenting to regulatory proposals, etc., that cover that topic. So for instance, this upcoming fintech public comment period, public comment letter there. And the second one is XBRLCH. Does anyone know here what XBRL stands for? Ever heard of it? No? shaking hands, heads, okay. XBRL stands for Extensible Business Reporting Language. It's a data format that is mandatory in the US, for instance, that is going to be mandatory in the EU by 2020, that all listed companies need to report mandatorily their financial numbers in that format. In Switzerland, nobody's heard of it. So that's interesting, shall we say. All right, so this is basically tonight's presentation. I am going to briefly touch on what happened so far. You can't read that now, you will later on. Then I will discuss what contemporary finance is about, contemporary fintech, I need to say. And then finally, I'll briefly discuss the genuine juncture that I believe our economies are actually currently at, and this is represented by what the fintech discussion really is about. So let me get into the details. And we're actually starting in Paris, France, 1765, so a little while back. That is when a certain T, we only know the first letter of his surname, first name is T. Boulanger. He seems to have been the first restaurateur in France, bringing together basically all the different kinds of dishes that nowadays we're used to having in a restaurant. Prior to that, when you wanted to eat out, you had to go to one shop, buy your mutton, to the other shop, get your soup, to the third shop, get your salad, and fourth, your sauce. Mr. Boulanger here has actually brought everything together, bundled it, put a nice place, hopefully, I presume, a nice place around it, and created a restaurant, a new customer experience to his clients. And for that, obviously, he was sued by the Guild of Saucier and the Charcutier. And because they felt that that their business model is actually being endangered by this revolutionary move of bundling food into a one client experience where a person can just go there and buy their menu in one place. Outrageous, right? So that's basically what they did. So a couple of hundred years back. But they lost. The lawsuit, that is. So basically the clients then started to get that opportunity of really going to one place and have the possibility to buy the experience of the menu. And you may wonder why I have Jamie Dimon here, the chairman of JP Morgan. That's because he recently said that he's afraid that fintech is going to eat their lunch. So basically that's the whole nervousness in the financial services industry, that there's outsiders coming into the business model of the financial services industry. Is that justified? We shall see. What you see here is actually the fintech opportunity, and that is also the title of a seminal paper by Philippon of last year. The fintech opportunity here is represented very nicely in that chart, spanning back to the 1880s. And what's represented here is the unit cost of financial intermediation. Don't ask me all the technical details of how this is calculated in a financial services provision. But again, it's a reputational issue. Philippon has a very high reputation among the guild of economists. Basically, he drew up this representation of this of the unit cost over those decades. And what's pretty remarkable is that the unit cost has been pretty stable over all these decades. And despite of all the intensifying and horrible, if you listen to financial services, competition out there, which technically should be driving unit costs down, obviously. That's also what is obviously happening in other industries. So unit costs, if there's no change in quality, and this is even quality adjusted, should be coming down. So what's happening, or why is this not happening here? And let's have a look at what the real world, or what in the real world might be happening. This here is a 1971 VW Beetle. And I'm representing this here because we have a very nice comparison by the CEO or former CEO of Intel. If the 1971 Beetle had the same technical progress like an Intel processor of 1971, it would burn, I don't know what you say there, it's probably milliliters per 100 kilometer of fuel. Would run at 483,000 kilometers per hour and cost 5 cents. So that's pretty impressive in terms of the advantage or the progress that's been made in these just like 40 years, right? And we're nowhere near seeing anything even remotely comparable to that. So, but what happened so far? Let's have a look at the innovation of the financial services industry so far, or finance more broadly speaking. And obviously, this is very broad brush.
Is it a fair comparison, production as a car and service to compare? Do you have any data on other services, how the costs have changed?
That's actually a good point. No, I haven't. It would probably make sense to look at other services as well. The question is whether the quality actually is changing and the leverages is changing. But I think the scalability of financial services would actually allow for these different more price competition to be effective or to be more effective. I mean, for instance, if you look at the typical example of the hairdresser, there's only one head that you can cut the hair off at one time, I suppose. Good point. Thank you. So, first innovation. That's going back in the gray times of history, or the really first innovation is being lost in history, and that is basically money. I don't need to remind this round here of the basic functions of money. Those are these three. And by the way, let me just comment on the whole negative interest rate thing discussion, where some economists actually say that they see this as negative interest rates, they see this as critical to maintain the nature of money. But I think what I never see mentioned in that context is that actually the store of value is being compromised in that situation. That seems to be taken out of that discussion. But what I actually like is that that little quote here by again, the founder actually of JP Morgan, and this presentation is not sponsored by JP Morgan. John Pierpoint saying that gold is money, or money is gold, and everything else is credit. We'll actually touch on that later on. Obviously, nowadays, in the days of fiat money, you need to replace gold with fiat or anything, but the fact is there is something that is created probably out of thin air, and then the banking system adds on to it, and that is credit that is being created. We'll touch on that later. So, if you ask the typical economist on the street, if there is such a person, what is financial innovation, then they will very quickly come up with the quote from Paul Volcker, former Fed chairman, who said that that the only financial innovation that he can think of that's worth its salt over the last generation was the ATM, the hole in the wall. And obviously there's been a lot of nervousness when that thing was introduced back in the 1970s. about what impact that would have on the financial services industry, all the jobs that would be lost thanks to having that. I found another very interesting piece of research about the actual impact that this has had. And what you see here is actually the jobs, the tellers, the bank teller jobs over the since the introduction of the ATM and the ATMs installed. And that is quite actually surprising, isn't it? You can actually see here that that the while the number of ATMs has obviously gone up very severely, the job destruction that has been expected did not really happen. And why is that? Because the quality of the ATM jobs, of the teller jobs, has changed very significantly. Whereas people in the old days were really just busy counting out the banknotes and handing over to people, nowadays they are expected to, or their job actually is to, well, to use the politically correct term, is to advise customers, or to use the real term, is to sell product to customers. And that's that is their job nowadays, and that's why the touch points with clients have changed very much in quality. So when you now go to the hole in the wall, you get your cash out, and that's the touch point that is very utilitarian, very functional. But if you seek out a bank staffer, if you have a contact point with somebody at a bank, then you have probably a more complex issue that you would like to discuss, maybe not, but definitely the bank person will try to involve you in a discussion about these bank services and try to add value, hopefully, to that. And that's basically that's the change in quality that has been happening. And maybe that's going back also to your question that you've been asking there about the unit cost. So, and then another one, a little bit shorter in history. I mentioned that money is back in ancient history. This is actually the joint stock company. Here, thanks to Wikipedia, I found a transfer letter, a settlement document, as it were, of a transfer of some stock by Bishop Peter of Lasteras, who reacquires an eighth of a mountain that basically belonged to a mine. And that is basically the separation that is represented here between property rights and management, which is the key innovation of the joint stock company. Also the limited liability of shareholders. So really that distinction between the entrepreneur, the entrepreneur obviously is the impersonation of all the risk and the activity and the management, and eventually also the capital. And nowadays, or with the introduction of the joint stock company, you actually can differentiate. You can differentiate between the financing and the actual management of that entrepreneurialism. That's something that's obviously been extremely successful over the last couple of centuries. What's even been more successful or more rapidly successful is actually one very special case of this joint stock company, and this is the investment vehicles, collective investment vehicles, here represented by a couple of charts from Boston Consulting, representing the recent developments of that industry as a whole. And here you can see that it's an extremely profitable industry with net profit margins, stable net profit margins, or operating profit margins as share of net revenue in the 30 to 40%, which over time, again, is a very high profit margin, obviously. And here you can see how the product offering is expected to be developing over the next couple of years, moving certainly from the what's called the active management, which is particularly where my members are very much involved in, towards a more passive industry perspective. But then again, you have on the right-hand side with a very high net revenue margin and pretty significant growth, there's the more private markets, so move away maybe from the liquid markets, which is really developing in that perspective. So the investment management industry, the asset management industry, as a very special case of the joint stock company, has been growing explosively over those last, well, three, 4 decades actually. And last but not least, we have Mr. Buffett here, representing risk transfer mechanisms, or also known as derivatives. And I know you can actually argue about what the functions of derivatives are, whether that's really the only one or the most important one even. But he thinks, or actually said that back in 2002, I think, that derivatives are weapons of financial mass destruction, or financial weapons of mass destruction. I think back in 2011, he bought some pretty significant weapons of mass destruction. So I'm not sure whether he would still stick to that. But here, some very important innovations have been made with, for instance, credit default swaps, again, where you can differentiate between the risk that you have in a bond position and the actual default risk of that position. You can insure against that. Same thing in interest rate swaps, options, etc. But in front of this audience, I don't think I need to go any much further in that regard. So that's basically just been an introduction into what happened so far when it comes to innovation in finance. Wondering, what do you guys think? Have I overlooked a major piece of innovation in finance here?
What about the Bitcoin
concept? We'll get to
that. Great.
I would say that is not finance, that's actually a technological innovation.
But the concept behind really has a huge impact on the fintech sector, right?
Like I say, we will get to that. I'm trying to think of real hardcore finance innovation concepts. Yes, please. Securitization.
Bad reputation, but nothing real
innovation. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, sure. I mean, you could say that maybe that joint stock, etc., is a bit of that. It's a representation of the assets and make them tradable in a way. So, yeah.
Central clearing.
Central clearing.
I mean, it's a solution to a problem that arose because of the derivatives.
And the question is whether it's going to be stable. Now the discussion about central clearing is only beginning to bubble up in my mind, as far as I can see.
But I would say the entire idea of having a stock exchange or a place where you can exchange your rights.
Mm-hmm.
Of one thing I would say is if you just own the right, but the other is, can I trade it? Can I sell it if I want?
Yeah. So the Amsterdam coffee house is basically transferring that. The price creation, the development of price mechanisms and making them transparent eventually, trying to distill information from these price developments. That's actually a good point. I think that's really not covered anywhere here. As a function in that sense.
All efficiency in the industry, straight through processing, no physical settlement anymore,
mm-hmm.
No cash against delivery.
Well, a lot of that, again, is probably really just using technology in finance. So I wouldn't say it's really a finance innovation per se, as opposed to, for instance, the mechanism of discovering prices and valuation in that sense. Okay.
So there's only one thing that I miss. That's banks. They were once an innovation too. And I agree, since then, not a lot has happened. But banks, once they started doing their job, that's something that
true.
I was missing here.
Collecting
yeah.
money. Well, I would say, I would then argue, I would then refer you back to this sir, mister here. Basically, the rest is credit. When you actually have, when you start collecting money from your clients and then create credit, that would be at least implied in there. I'm not trying to defend anything, but
that's probably then more than one innovation, really. I mean, banks is someone that just stores your money away, as, I don't know, probably centuries ago, and someone that can create money out of thin air. That's a different concept, that you can just create credit.
Yeah, but back
risk diversification. Don't forget that.
Back then, it wasn't really regulated in that sense. So you had different banking cultures, basically, really were just focusing on that. Others were creating credit, went bust after a while. So, all right, let's continue. Basically, let's have a look at contemporary fintech. So, what all this, let me say the word, the hype actually is all about. And I do have a strong feeling that much of the whole discussion is really approaching a feverish point of hypiness here in that context. So what's happening? There's obviously a huge proliferation of business models. So there's different types of business models, front, left, and center, but they have really just been focusing on speed and on price. Well, there's nothing bad with speed and price, obviously. Well, that's the business model, by the way. Just this web, if you look at that, which is from a report that's been published by IOSCO yesterday. It's the global fintech landscape, which they categorize along those broad categories of payments, insurance, planning, that is personal finance, that sort of thing, lending, crowdfunding, the blockchain, obviously, trading and investments, data and analytics, and security. I think that's a fairly comprehensive mapping that they've done here. What's been quite impressive, and I really recommend that report, is they've shown that the development of that web here, of that Klüngel, over the last decade. And in the beginning, there was like nothing, a couple of threads. Now there's this very, very intricately developed core web here of these business models. But like I said, there's nothing against price and speed, because that's the foundations or the fundamental elements that you can really build your corporate strategy on. And here I love to quote Jeff Bezos, the founder of Amazon, who said, basically this is in the context of, he's often being asked, how is the world going to look like in 10 years' time? What's going to change in 10 years' time? What he's actually saying is, we should really not focus on what is going to change in 10 years' time, but really what's going to stay the same in 10 years' time. Because if you want to really develop a business model that is worth its salt, then it should survive 10 years. And that's basically the stuff that he's been focusing Amazon on. He's basically been looking at the situation where, what do clients want actually from a platform like Amazon? It's basically a low price and it's very fast delivery. And here he's it's explaining, it's unimaginable that people say they love Amazon if only they will charge a little bit more or deliver a little bit slower. And that's truly unimaginable in my mind. So let's now have a closer look at what that categorization that we've seen before is actually shaping up to be in a more more analytical mindset, and I like to have, I'm a simple mind, I like to have that thing in its drawers and categories a little bit. And these are the classical, in a way, functions of financial services. So you have your payments functions. Obviously, you have your credit function, credit creation, credit distribution, as it were. You have securities issuing, safekeeping, trading, that whole part of the industry. The advisory, when it comes to the different arms where you actually earn commissions on that. The clearing and settlement, which is a whole sub-part of the industry. And then you can actually think of how does, and these are the three main forces that I see as being effective in this whole fintech definition. How do these three main forces really influence these silos in the industry? And I think that very many of these business models, the nodes of those business models are being hyped up right now, because most of them that we've seen before are actually developing in that hype cycle. And here's the Gartner hype cycle that I'm sure everybody is familiar with, where you actually have the technology trigger when something is really coming up and being started to discover, being discovered and being developed, being invested in. Then you go to a peak of inflated expectations, which I would argue we're probably quite close to, which then will crash down to earth, but it's not going to disappear. There's going to be a trough of disillusionment, and then it will come back up again, slope of environment, plateau of productivity. There is going to be a long-term impact of things. But the whole history of the dot-com bubble is the excellent representation of what's been happening. Nowadays, we couldn't imagine a world without the internet anymore. Amazon, again, if you've seen what happened yesterday when the Amazon Web Services broke down, I think Amazon could probably be seen as too big to fail almost. if Amazon's stopped working, or the web services of Amazon stopped working, we would really have very big problems for at least a while. So, like I said, if you think about, if you think of, or if you look at the business models, the nodes that we've seen in that little web before, think of how they are influenced by these three forces in their respective silos. Then just ask yourself, where are these business models with regards to that hype cycle? But let me first explain what I mean by the different terms here. Obviously, digitalization is the first force, and I like to think of here in terms of the music industry, because the music industry is a wonderful example for what's been happening here. Obviously, you have the live experience where your musician is actually creating music, which is totally analog, and it's perishable. It goes away the minute it's being created. That's a very particular experience. Then it's being recorded traditionally analog, and it's being distributed on recordings that way, which are physical. That's the traditional vinyl recording that you've had. Then it started the first wave of digitalizations with when analog recordings were transferred into CDs, compact discs, with digital information on them. And ultimately, the actual product was the pure digital content was pulled away, so to speak, from the digitalization, from that bundle of the compact disc. So there's a whole huge range of that value creation chain that is involved in music, which is really influenced by this digitalization. Now, how does that, what's the impact of that on financial services? You could actually say that, well, money is actually already digital, if you like, unless you have your banknote or you're dealing with cash or anything. And therefore, financial services are fully digitized. But I don't think that's really true, because the actual service is actually not the number that you have on your bank account or that you're dealing with in your bank account. It's basically the for instance the transactions when you buy or sell a security. It's again it's the contract that you're entering when you actually get a mortgage. All these types of things are service businesses which are nowhere near digitized at all. Across the different value chains there. Then the second force here is bundling or unbundling. So basically just changing the different ways in which parts of services are being pulled together or disintegrated. Again, very nice example is the compact disc, where you actually had to buy a bundle of individual songs or music pieces. And maybe you just wanted to have one of them and you still were forced to actually buy the whole bundle of the songs in there. But when you actually have the possibility of just getting one piece of that bundle, then you'll just go for that. You'll pay obviously much less for the digital content, much more practical, and you can basically ditch the whole physical part of things. So that's the power of unbundling, which I've also mentioned at the outset with that restaurant image, remember, back 1765. I think the impact of technology nowadays is such that that we have many more possibilities to change the bundles that all kinds of services are being delivered to customers. And that has enormous influences because it typically was just a historically grown way of doing business which is now being changed. And the ultimate example of that is actually you've talked about banks as an innovation. I think nowadays banks are probably, or the way I think of banks is just that they're one huge balance sheet which basically brings together all different kinds of or represents all different kinds of financial services bundled in a way. But you could actually think of unbundling most of those functions outside of the very traditional banking function, which is obviously Fristentransformation. I'm not really sure what the English term for that is, that classical part of the banking function. Could pull that part that apart and then make that accessible to more boutique or more targeted kinds of business models as well, in an industrialized way of doing financial services. And that brings me to the third force, which is actually part of the unbundling, because once you actually pull service offerings apart, then obviously you can actually also use different parties to participate in the transactions involved in this unbundled services. So it's not just disintermediation, but it's also re-intermediation. So it's the changes, basically, of the intermediary. Either introducing new intermediaries, think of robo-advisors inserting themselves between execution platforms or execution banks and the end client, stuff like that. But all these functions that we have so far, that we have seen so far, that we have discussed so far, really are stuck in a web of functional silos. And those are the functional silos that that we've just seen previously. these bits here. If you look at banking operations in their organization, they are very much siloed. And there are specialists in each of those silos, and they just deliver what their silos are meant to deliver. So that siloization is really a critical part of the business models that fintech is now operating in. And that's something that, in my mind, hinders really their growth. And here's a quick strategy interplay. So what does the fintech development that we've seen over the last 5 to 10 years maybe, what impact does that have on corporate strategy, either of the big institutions or also of the small ones? And there's again three forces. The rule of three I've recently learned you should always use in presentations, because you shouldn't use more than 3 points, becomes much more complex. So basically, you have again two elements here which are counteracting each other: size and agility. So huge organizations do obviously have benefits of scale and everything. That's the way banks, large financial services operations actually grew. But also probably a function of regulation. They've lost much of their agility, or they are nowhere near as agile as small organizations, small boutiques can be. That is basically the recipe for that concept that I now see developing in financial services and fintech discussion of frenemies. Friendly enemies or co-opetition, that's cooperation and competition. So a really very confusing situation where some players are actually competing with, say, banks or large operators, and still they see that by themselves they really don't have the stamina to go through, because maybe they don't have the capital base, or their clients don't react fast enough. So that they actually have to find a way of cooperation with their competition. And that makes life, strategically speaking, very tricky, very difficult. That's what I mentioned with client inertia. That's particularly true in B2C, in the business to client space, not so much in the B2B space, where when you have professionals on both sides, they're much more focused on the actual service delivery. And lastly, one thing: who remembers Ronald Coase?
Good.
I think Coase is actually going to come back into his honor nowadays. He's basically, if I can just paraphrase a little bit, the Coase theorem is the company size is basically determined by the cost differential, transaction cost differential inside and outside of the company. Is that half? Does that work in a way? And if transaction costs outside are falling, and I would venture to say that they're falling dramatically, or have fallen dramatically, and continue to fall dramatically, then that has an impact, needs to have an impact on the size of the firm as well. So in that sense, in the sense of that Coase theorem, you could actually expect that financial services will spawn many more small firms with much more specialized offerings that will try to disintermediate and unbundle the traditional manufacturing balance sheet of the bank. That's my major expectation actually of the impact of the fintech discussion on financial services. And that's the big fear. That's a big fear that the financial services industry is having. And here I've copied a slide from a recent Apple presentation, which is showing the ranking of Apple's watch sales as you know, it's been introduced not too long ago, the Apple Watch, and it's now on rank 2 after Rolex, before Fossil, Omega, Cartier, Citizen, etc., in terms of sales, which is obviously something that frightens the living daylight of the watch industry. Because an outsider who's never done anything with watches just can start a product and like that get to rank 2. Is that going to happen with financial services? And that's what I'm actually would posit to you. That's what I think is actually going to happen here. We are at a real juncture. By the way, my time is up, so I'll have to hurry up a little bit. We're, I believe, at the genuine juncture now, which will allow us to recode the operating system of the economy at large. And I would venture to say that all the pieces, all the concepts, all the technologies to actually do that are currently available. So this is not vaporware or anything. These are existing concepts that can be put into place, that can be determined and decided upon. It's basically an engineering task, what I see here. But it's got huge demands on policymakers and on politics as well. So this is not really a fintech proposition or a business model proposition. It's just as much a regulatory issue that I'll be talking about, and we'll see why. We have Mr. Lilbert here. There's for this time, I'm breaking the rule of three. I'm propositioning four elements. First one is property rights. Property rights, especially with big assets, are usually represented by legal title. So for instance, when you have a house, that legal title to the house is only validly represented by the Grundbuch, whatever that is in English. So you have a directory of grand property. Also, when you have cars, etc., you have to have your car permit, which is the representation of that car. I'm actually claiming that we will see a much more intricate registry of property rights developing, and this is now where blockchain is coming into its honor, probably based on some kind of a blockchain protocol, which will allow all types of registries for property rights of all different kinds. So when I talk about real estate or car, that's just one part. Another completely different part is, for instance, the right to the information that your Fitbit, your fitness device creates, which is hugely interesting for many operators out there, for instance, your health insurance, etc. They'd be willing, I'm sure, to pay quite a lot of money for this kind of information. But to actually have a structure in place that will allow to define and transact on these property rights, that's what's required in that way. So, property rights. Second is contracts. By the way, only the blockchain and contracts is really a hot topic of discussion right now. The other three aren't. So contracts, I'm very happy to actually say that this is a development by a Zurich guy, Urs Brammertz. Maybe somebody knows him here. He's written the book on standardized contracts, I think. And that is this unified financial analysis. Look it up, very worthwhile your attention. They've developed a taxonomy of 32 very simple contract types that are modular and standardized. So you have input factors and output factors of those contract types. One example for a contract type is an annuity contract or a Sparheft contract, and you can combine those in code, those contract types, to build as complex contracts as you like. And these types of contracts are obviously code. It's as simple as that. You can code these and you can build these things together and again share them by whichever way you like or you determine is useful. Third piece, valuation. And this is where the XBRL part comes in, because the essential part of valuation is you need to have financial information and preferably standardized financial information. And that's what these kinds of data formats do. They make available not proprietary formats like Thomson Reuters or Bloomberg, etc., within their proprietary models. But these are just the valuation or the financial reporting data that are being created by reporting entities left, right, and center, and then made available in the cloud to whoever wants to use them. And last but not least, money. And that is where I believe the real clincher is going to be for financial services. I really wonder why this is not being more broadly discussed, but you may have seen that, for instance, the Swedish Riksbank is looking at creating their own version of cryptocurrency. The Bank of England is looking at it. I'm sure the National Bank is also working on that. I think as soon as you actually give access to digital money to non-banks, the whole game of financial services is up for financial service providers. Because that's when the Apples and the Googles and the Alibabas can actually come in and play at the same level without having that intermediary of the banking system. They can actually get direct access to central bank money without having to be licensed or without having that banking license there. And they're not creating any particular systemic risk because of that, because the reason for systemic risk, if I can totally butcher the complexity of it, is really the credit creation. If you take that part out of the picture, then you just have your regular counterparty risk, and that's much more easily handled. So I think those are the four key pieces that will make the difference in the fintech development going forward. And they are not really fintech. They're very much economic in nature, legal in nature, political in nature. They will make a huge difference in what the financial services is going to do. And here I'm quoting recent Nobel Prize guy, Robert Shiller: how can finance as a science, as a practice, the source of economic innovation, promote freedom, prosperity, equality, and economic security? That's what the job to be done is for the financial services industry effectively. And I think with the use of technology, it will also allow us to have much more transparent and symmetric information about what is happening in financial services. So, and that's my last slide. I believe that the race is actually on. There's a lot of movements in many different jurisdictions going on to start implementing these building blocks into their jurisdictions. For instance, Dubai, there's a lot of movement happening there when it comes to government business on the blockchain. Singapore is very, very active in that space. And I think our focus on just fintech regulation, sandbox, etc., is much too narrow in terms of what is the real impact going to be on the systemic changes that will be happening out of these developments. That's it. I'm way overdue. Sorry about that. But do you have any questions?
Sure. Let me break the ice with the questions. What we see so far in the fintech sector is a lot of companies, they enter a some kind of business, some kind of industry that is fairly high margin now, and they act as discounters and hope to capture market share this way. Do you think we'll ever see something other than discounters in these sectors? Something more akin to a luxury goods provider or somebody that actually is not just trying to be the cheapest possible, but actually that offers some sort of value that people are willing to pay for more than the marginal cost?
I'm sure of it. That's going to happen. But what's first got to happen, I think, is that you could argue that the outsized profitability of the financial services model will have to be destroyed first, before you can start rebuild that value add creation. So that's a question of time, where you can differentiate the different types of offerings.
Mm-hmm. So basically now, in order to go to fintech, we are more in the tech zone. So yeah, efficiency and
price and speed.
Yeah, and in order to redesign the whole system in the end, would that be the way it's going?
I'm not sure I get your question.
In order to rethink the whole system, the whole process, because fintech would be an innovation, not only just with technology and something like that, would be one of the way to first go in that digitalization area, and then going there, at some point it would be then possible to rethink the whole the whole system economy, how we.
Yeah, the thing is, there's obviously many private operators are now moving in that space and trying to change the way they do business, but currently within their silos. I don't see much that is cutting across silos, and especially I see there is a strong impact of regulation on the way those silos are structured. And that's why I think the big impact is only going to come when regulators and basically the policymakers begin to understand that this is a much wider move, that we actually have to look at how do you manage property rights, how do you manage contracts, how can you get efficiencies out of the money access, for instance. These are the overarching pillars that our economy is resting on, and these will be changed actually. And then actually you will have the silos that will start to fizzle out at the fringes.
Okay. If all different functions now disembark into their own regions, do we even have the right people to still advise a client? I mean, now you can look around inside your bank and you'll find an expert for everything. Mm-hmm. But how do you deal with the growing complexity of silos growing everywhere?
Excellent point. Probably not. But there's nothing as changeable as people. I mean, when a bank says the human resources is our capital, that's not true. The capital walks out of the door every evening, right? The thing is, people are changing and they learn. That's basically what we do. As for instance, when you look at the CFA curriculum, that's changing all the time. And we're currently looking at building in the impacts that these business models are having on financial service creation, on the formulation of your investment policy statement, etc. How you do that. So I think that's not so much my concern actually, because people are very dynamic in terms of how they change their qualifications.
What interests me is who is, if there is going to be a fintech revolution, who's going to drive it?
Okay.
There are basically three possibilities. The incumbents, the banks themselves, the big technology companies, Google, Facebook, Apple, Amazon, are new players. Mm-hmm. What we have seen so far is we have new players coming into the market and not really
names.
Excuse me?
Name names, please.
true wealth.
Mm-hmm. Let's look at true wealth. Mm-hmm. They came into business with really good technology.
I'm a client, but
I think everybody that has looked at what they offer has to agree that what they do is really good. Are they successful? Not at all. So what they're lacking is trust. They don't have the trust.
If you have to open an account with Saxo Bank to become a client with them.
No. They do that for you. That's the difference.
At the very end, it's a Saxo Bank account behind, and I don't trust them.
That's going to change in 2 months.
The point I was trying to make is, I was asked for an example, new players. That's what we've seen so far. So I personally think if it's really going to be interesting, if it's not the banks or new players, but the GAFA guys, Google, Amazon, Facebook, mm-hmm. Apple guys who are going to try.
Totally agree.
And why would they not? Why would they not? So my expectation is that the fintech revolution, if it's going to come, it's going to come from that side.
Yeah.
What do you think?
They're waiting for the central bank access. That's what I think.
And they will get regulations from the EU, for example, which will disintermediate more and make the market entrance for new players a lot easier.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, just think of Apple Pay. Apple Pay is a very nice interface. I'm a fan of Apple Pay. It's a fantastic product. It's a very nice interface to your credit card, nothing else. But Apple can very easily and immediately pull out the credit card as soon as they have direct access to the payment system. And they will do that in a flash.
They could, yeah. They could do it now.
Maybe related to this question, I think, do you think that there can be finance players that are not fintechs, that lack the engineering and technological basis that fintechs now have?
Maybe
10 years? I mean, because all the financial services
are
digital.
Mm-hmm.
And
What are you thinking about? Your independent wealth manager?
Everyone who wants to compete in this market and wants to offer services needs to have engineering, needs to have the technology and the guys who know the technology to be actually able to provide the service to the market.
I get your question. Not right now, but it's not too far away because there's an increasing number of providers of run-of-the-mill white-label services. Only yesterday I saw a headline of a what's a bank called? There was a bank founded in London which doesn't cater to retail clients. They just cater as a clearing platform to fintech service providers, etc. I think there's going to be a development of an ecosystem of service providers which cater very specific services to other service providers which are clients of those. Think of the whole cloud computing idea, basically. Not too long ago, you actually had to maintain your own server farms to operate, for instance, a web shop or a huge website or anything. To operate that on. Nowadays, you can actually buy computing powers. It's not too far away that you can buy computing power, excess computing power, on an exchange. And that's just a commodity, computing power, connected computing power. And I'm sure that the same thing will be happening for very dedicated and specialized financial services like account opening, etc. It's commodity. It's commodity. Yeah. And these services are going to be highly commoditized, totally cut price in terms of competition because there's huge competitive forces at play. They're all about scalability again. And I mentioned Amazon Web Services. That's basically the kind of scale that is at play there. You have another question then?
Yeah, I just wanted to add on Matthias what he said. You have as well Facebook that enables now transmitting some money from using basically the Messenger app. But then thinking and going from there, don't you think that such providers, I mean, they are so big that they can only go as far as basic financing services, and still you need a small structure to be more focused in a way. I mean, they have a huge base, a huge community, and for them it's interesting only because they can serve a lot of.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but since you mentioned Facebook, I'm not a fan. What's special with Facebook is they will cater with their own services to the community that they believe they can serve best, which is a huge base. But obviously they're opening up their APIs to third parties for more complex, more specialized services. So you can actually develop a very intricate, again, ecosystem, system of service providers based on these platforms. If they're opening those up, and they have every interest to do that. Again, Apple Pay, 15 basis points, right?
It's more a comment from my side, also on just my own opinion, given that so much digitalization will happen, and in conversation with other people, I sometimes hear, yeah, but where's the personal touch, where's the human interaction? And also here, we've had this a little bit, I think, if people are willing to pay for that, somebody's going to offer it.
Mm-hmm. I don't think people are looking for the personal touch when they're looking for a financial transaction. I mean, there's no personal touch in getting cash out of the hole in the wall, right? So that's purely utilitarian.
I mean, more like
it's just habits
for something like wealth management or something.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe
possibly.
It's not the personal touch, maybe it's the experience.
Habit.
You know? Yeah, exactly. I mean, in your intro slides, you said that innovation is about changing the experience and make it better for the customers, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one aspect I missed a little bit in your concluding remarks.
Mm-hmm.
I think that along with technology, or technology allows to change the experience and to make it more fancier, more Apple, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that is a main aspect as well, which should be mentioned.
I absolutely agree with you. But what I'm discussing here is infrastructure.
I see, okay.
And the client experience is something completely different. That's basically the service provider, where there will be a huge competitive landscape. Each one will provide their own user interface, their own surface, basically. And they will compete with others with that, because that is the major differentiator. The underlying services provided, they're largely commoditized, and that's why I didn't really touch on it. But it's hugely important.
Okay, if it's okay for everyone, shall we continue the discussion downstairs at the upper row?
Absolutely. I wouldn't say
no. Thanks a lot for the talk.